This is the board that I'm sorry. Right.
This is the door?
The steam board.
Mr. Miller?
Yeah.
Mr. Miller?
Present.
A form is present, shall be passed to salute the flag.
Please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I
stretch and continue the great work. But most importantly, during this time, I hope you take a few minutes and catch your breath, get well, get strong, and come back ready to go. You are doing some awesome work, and we're so proud. What you may not be aware of, as we're filming this tonight, we want you to know that the Student Board of Education Day, and alongside me is our student superintendent for the day. She'll be leaving the meeting tonight at the board meeting, so we're looking forward to a fantastic evening, and I'd like to introduce to you Superintendent Dick.
Hello. As Mr. Isola was saying, you are working phenomenally and continue on with your work ethic because it's working great and we want you to have a very pleasant spring break. Rest, do whatever you please, and you are recognized and you are appreciated. So thank you very much and have a good spring break.
We're excited to recognize this year's student participants in Howell Township Public Schools' third annual Student Board of Education Day. This day recognized the hard work and dedication of the members of the Board of Education and allowed students to experience the important role each member plays in the education of our students. Selected fifth grade students served as members of the Board of Education, attended committee meetings, and learned about the responsibilities members of the board assume. Total of 15 students, three from each 3-5 school, were selected based on the content of their responsible writing prompt. This year's prompt was, if you were to serve as a member of the Howell Township Board of Education, what policies would you implement or support in order to promote a healthy, responsible, and safe learning environment for all students? The selected students are in attendance tonight so that we may celebrate selection and participation in this year's events. This year's participants were Samantha Hill, Lauren Jarman, Christelle Wilton, Zach Metzger. year, Howell Township sends our seventh grade Project Plus students to the Scholastic Olympics at Dominican Catholic. The event is designed to stimulate educational interest and recognize academic achievement. There are several areas of competition: art, English, history, spelling, math, science, technology, and music. Gold, silver, and bronze medals are awarded in each division. Each year, we always do a fantastic job. I thank the advisors for all they do to prepare the students. We had overall for third place for middle school north team, first place in the division, Howell South, third place in the division, but there were also many individual medal winners, which I'd like to read off. I'd also like to give an opportunity for Mr. Higginson, and we'll start with Sal to say a few words before we do that.
And Mr. Higginson, the first time, Father.
Mr. Thor and Dr. Jeffries.
There you go. Come on up, guys. Thanks so much.
Just want to tell you a little bit about the competition that we were at. It was, for an academic competition, it was very exciting. Well, that sounds a little unusual. But it was like a horse race. It came down to the wire. We were in the largest division, largest school division in the entire thing. And there's 16 categories, and there's three medals for each category. It came down to the last medal in the last category. And whoever won that medal, North, South, or Toms River North, won the whole thing. And it was a battle back and forth. North took a big lead, Toms River North took a lead, and suddenly the South jumped up into the bunch of them. And whoever won that last one, we were all sitting there next to each other, waiting to see who gets that call. So it was right down to the wire. And it was exciting. So the people that I have here tonight that placed for me was the first person, who I think this is the toughest category to place in, as far as I'm concerned. And he placed in art. He got a bronze in art. Andrew Delaney. Another tough category, technology, Jacob Wazicki. And somebody that didn't think she would do well in her category, but did very well in her category, a silver medal, Allison Zerbe. One of the leaders in our class for the Project Plus, somebody that's a standout, an excellent student all around, she took a silver medal in music, Cassidy Brennan.
Thank you.
title and spelling goes to David Dickenbach. The silver medal in history goes to Samuel Potenziana. The bronze medal in math goes to Julian Sanchez. And the gold medal in history goes to Alina Abrahamson. The silver medal in technology goes to Kyle Nugent.
Hello, hello.
And the bronze medal in science goes to Jeremy Lozano. Yes.
Take a 2 minute recess and the parents file outside. Yes, it is time for an executive session. Please note the motion printed in the agenda. Items this evening include the HIP report, discussion of contract for assistant superintendents and administrative contracts, superintendent pre-conference, administrative organization, 3 personnel issues on agreements that the Labor Committee reviewed on the evening. With that, sir, may we have a mover and a second for executive session? The board is in executive session. We will return to business after that.
Make their way back to the dais. The board is back in session. May I take the minute, sir?
Please.
Do we have a mover and a second for the minutes?
Somebody move and second.
Move it.
Moved by Ms. Malley, second by Ms. Mangano. May I take that around, sir?
Please.
Mrs. Malley?
Yes.
Mrs. Mangano? Mr. Gurman has left the meeting. Dr. Jeffrey?
Yes.
Dr. Lowe?
Yes.
Mrs. Okerson?
Yes.
Mr. Thor? Yes. Thank you. Mr. Miller? Mr. Miller is not present at the dais yet. Mr. Bongiovanni?
Yes.
The minutes are approved. 6 votes in favor with the abstention noted for the record. The correspondence the board has received will be noted for the record. It is now time for board president's comments. Mr. Bongiovanni, president of the Board of Education, your comments, sir.
Thank you. Since we have not had a meeting since the national conference took place I'd like to just discuss that for a bit. This board, Mr. Izzola and myself presented at a session, and a number of the board members and administrators were in the room at the time. It was wonderful being able to share some of the information out to districts and administrators from across the country on some of the work that this board does. And as always happens in those situations, we continue to learn from those conversations. You know, it was great answering the questions and hearing comments, and it gives you time after each presentation to go back and reconsider and relook at what you've presented. Did we do this right? Is there something here we want to tweak, something we want to change? And I think it's a great credit to this board, really a board as a team, and the administration, how many requests we've heard from other committees, other districts, other supervisors across the country. Hey, can we talk to you a little bit more about that? So that was just a really nice experience. Something else I want to talk about is that back on April 9th, New Jersey School Boards Association had their school mental health conference. Both Mr. Izzola and Mr. Miller and I were present at that time. It was a full day of talking about SEL issues, mental health issues, school culture, traumatic loss. It was really an important day learning in discussion about some of the items that this board has talked about before, discussed before, touched before, but I think what we, the three of us as we talked afterwards, I think what's very, very clear is that this is an issue that the board will need to continue to look at, and Mr. Izzola, I know, has taken this issue very much to heart in terms of his own activities, and you know, I just want to let everybody know, I think this is something that will continue to be a hot topic for us as we move forward. Last thing I want to do is give you a heads up. During Finance Committee tonight, the report from Finance as it comes about, we are going to have a discussion in terms of the budget. I think it's important that we're all here for this discussion because it's really one that I think, although no decisions will be made tonight, no votes will be taken tonight, but there will be a healthy discussion, I hope, amongst all the board members and administration who chooses to weigh in on where we're going to be May 6th. And I'll just say that it's an important topic. I would encourage everybody to speak your mind when we have that discussion afterwards. And with that, I'll conclude my report.
Thank you. It's now time for the superintendent board secretary's report. Superintendent of school, Mr. Izzola, your report, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. We'll just try to go through here. I know there's a lot from committee to discuss, so I'll try to get through the necessary updates and important information as quickly as possible. Today was an awesome experience at our board office, interacting with our 15 student board of education participants, and then we had the opportunity to see them at 6 o'clock this evening. It is so confirming and reassuring to see their work as young individuals, as young learners. It is certainly a something for all of us to take great pride in, that we provide these learning experiences, these life learning experiences, that the normal classroom experience or the traditional classroom experience would not afford them. So I would like to thank the board and commend you for your leadership in this way and providing opportunities for us to expand learning opportunities and stretch curriculums in a way that is truly impactful for students. I really got a tremendous sense that their takeaway was very valuable to them today. They've learned some really wonderful experiences through that work today. So, you know, I just wanted to note that and be appreciative of that opportunity and working with the kids. Today on the agenda, you will see the calendar. is being recommended for approval the next year's calendar. As you know, that process was delayed due to the fact we were working with our municipal and county partners on removing voting from our eight schools that were still voting sites. We were successful in making sure that voting would no longer take place in the schools for the upcoming year. We're very pleased about that. That allowed us to look at the calendar different. As I have done for all of my years as superintendent and Dr. Golden prior to me, we share that out with our stakeholder groups, the Board of Education, the President's Council, the PTO, PTAs, and CPAC presidents get that, as well as the Executive Board of the HTAC and the HTEA receive that, and through the Academic Council, where both groups meet, that is discussed at length in that process. So I solicit feedback. You saw the draft, and now you see the recommendation on the calendar tonight. It is definitely altered some. The predominant, the overwhelming feedback that I received was to have Howell Township K-8's spring recess, which we're about to go on this week, for the next year's calendar, to mirror that of the Freehold Regional High School District and some of the sending districts. We were able to do that. It required two additional days in the April break, which meant those days needed to be added back on in June. We're hopeful that Mr. Sanisak and Ms. Malley's committee operations will be reporting good news, and by the end of next school year, all of our buildings will be climate controlled, and it won't be such a dramatic issue as it was. The impact from due to climate in the learning environments won't be dampered or made to be difficult. So we're excited that could be a good result. However, personally, you saw the calendar that I put forth. I thought exiting school a little earlier would have been advantageous and more received well, but the feedback, if you're going to ask for feedback, and the feedback you get is reasonable and fits within the framework of your goals and your objectives, then, you know, be a leader that takes that feedback and acts on it. So while I was in favor of my original proposal, the feedback has directed me to present to you tonight and make a recommendation that differs a little bit from that, and I'm very comfortable with it. Like I said, it fits within my objectives and allows me to conduct an effective and meaningful school year, and that is my objective with the school calendar. So that's on the agenda for your approval tonight. We have some upcoming events. The HTEA will have their Race to Educate May 11th. I would like to say that this past Thursday, a week ago tomorrow, they held their Evening of the Stars right here, and it was a beautiful evening, and we had the great opportunity to recognize Mrs. Callender as one of Howell Township stars, and that's exactly what she is in her retirement. The foundation saw it fit to include her in the brick garden of stars for the Howell Township Education Foundation, and I know she was greatly appreciative of that, and it was a really special night. She had her daughters there. Her son was away at school, but her daughters were up, and certainly her husband and her sister. So it was a really wonderful night, as well as the other stars that we celebrated that evening. So kudos to the foundation for being great partners with our board and our district, and it was a truly great evening. On May 21st, the administration building will be participating in Be Like Jake, and will go gray in honor of children's cancer. I know a lot of these months and days and colors, and we're talking about that tonight a little bit. There's a lot of that, but Jay Koenig was a young child that was in our school district and ultimately lost his fight with cancer as just a young LOP student, and the family has been incredible to work diligently in areas of supporting families who are struggling with youngsters who are battling cancer. All the attention and any kind of fundraising that will go along with our efforts to wear gray will go towards one of their pillars. They have three pillars, and we've selected the pillar to go towards bringing smiles to children and families' faces who are struggling with this need. They have a research pillar, and they have an awareness pillar, and things of that nature, but we're going to be just trying to impact a positive environment for the family, and I've shared that with the principals. It's up to the school communities on whether or not they will be supporting going gray on May 21st, but certainly I want to share that with all of you. Mr. Preston will hand out the March suspension report. There are 20 suspensions, 15 out of school and 5 in school. As he hands that around for your review, I believe that will conclude my report this evening, sir.
Thank you, sir. As part of
sir,
the...
Sir, may I just add one thing?
Dr. Lowe has a question.
You said you were done.
I want to change my mind. Thank you, sir. I have to say it before some of our wonderful board members say it. I was able to, we were at the conference, so I didn't get to see Hairspray here at Middle School North, but I was at Middle School South's rendition of the West Side Story, the performance, and it was just another, I won't say anything more other than it was just another example of the amazing talent that lives in these schools and in this community. And I know there was many special kids on the stage, but I'm sure Ms. Malley will make reference to it as it gets around for her time to speak. So this time I'm going to say it before the board members, I attended West Side Story and I loved it.
Dr. Lowe?
Yes, so my question, and it may have, maybe I missed an email, but what are the benefits of aligning the calendar to Freehold
Regional?
Yeah, sure, Regional?
Thank you, Dr. Lowe. So the benefits are, so we're, as you know, we're a K-8, our kids feed to the high school. Many of our community members, we heard from some of the PTA presidents that they were hearing, and many of our staff members, have children who attend both the regional high school district as well as the K-8 district. And when they're disaligned, if the children are young, the high school student can't watch, it's daycare issues, it's travel, it creates travel issues. So the alignment of allows family time and opportunities for families to do things that they are choosing to do and not having to have students miss, whether it be the regional or our school day, making that choice to get it on one side or the other. So,
teachers
and
in
teachers, yes.
Regional that has kids here, or teachers here that have kids in regional also came up.
Right.
Just saying.
The voice I heard came from the staff. The voice I heard came from staff who are parents in the district, as well as the PTO and PTA President's Council. There was some conversation at that table as well. The board did not have that feeling. I didn't get any feedback from the board, but the HTAC, the HDAC, the HDAC, the HDEA groups, and the parent group did provide that level of feedback, so that's why I modified it. And again, I want to be really clear, I felt the modified calendar fell within my objectives as superintendent.
Yeah.
It did not hamper my ability to make sure that we were going to have meaningful instruction. And I've been on record as saying we don't design the calendar for vacations.
Okay.
We design the calendars for school. But if the request is reasonable and loud enough where it impacted a lot of people, we certainly want to be supportive of the family's desires. I am also very active, as you know, with my wellness movement, and family time is something that's valuable. And if families could escape for a couple days, whether it's a drive down to a local shore, or whether it's upstate, or whether it's getting on a plane, doesn't matter, whether it's having a barbecue in your backyard, if they can have all their kids and their family together, that's valuable time, and I saw the benefit to that. And like I said, it did not work against my objectives as the superintendent, so I was okay with it.
Mr. Rezzo, I'm going to touch one other topic also. Did that answer?
Yes, it did. And I think you have.
Go ahead.
I have another. I don't know, more of a comment or question, but my objection, and I did bring it to your attention about the calendar, was the fact that taking those 2 extra days, then added on 2 days at the end of the year, and since it's the last 2 days, they're half days, and it's 2 half days on a Monday and a Tuesday of the following week. So I don't personally see any educational value in having children come in for 2 half days and another additional week at the end of the year. So that's where my concern was. If there was a way to avoid that, it would have been better. But I completely understand the decision that you made, and I support that and respect it. That was just my point of contention with the change.
But the alternative to that is that you're taking the kids out of a week of school. Like, if they're going on vacation when the other kids are off, then they're missing 5 days of school as opposed to two half days.
They wouldn't be if you...
it would be in our case.
There's 2 days, Thursday and Friday of the week before the normal spring break, so...
But they had to be off anyway. The Thursday and Friday, you can't have school because of Passover. So it would have been the following week that the high school was off and the elementary school wasn't. If they're going away, then those kids are missing 5 days of school.
It was the 2 days in the previous week that were added. They weren't part of the original
school. They were. They were his initial week off. That's why he initially did that first
week. He had the week off before.
Right.
Yes,
and
the initial proposal had the week before leading into Good Friday and Easter. Yeah.
Yes.
And so those Thursday and Friday, that was the Passover. That's why you had to be off that day regardless. And then so it was the whole next week.
And just as a point of clarity, since we are on the
record. We don't get off for a holiday. We get off so people can observe a holiday.
Thank you, Mrs. Oakerson.
Got it.
The piece I was going to add, have we finished the calendar discussion? The piece I was going to add was, well, it's not necessarily this district related. Since you mentioned the Be Like Jake event, this board often talks about the fact that we are a community, whether we're talking about this building or school district or Howell. So as a community mention, I will say this, that the 27th of April, it's a Saturday. I know that Colts Neck and Howell High School have a lacrosse game at Howell High that day. That Saturday morning, they are selling shirts and doing a fundraiser for the Be Like Jake issue also. So, like I said, it's not necessarily this district, but it's community, and we are community. Mr. Sanasek.
Thank you. Further on the report from the board secretary, we received a request from the Monmouth County Office of the Department of Education to read a proclamation that the governor made into our record at our next meeting, which this is that next meeting. So if I may, a proclamation, whereas there are about 750,000 youth age 17 and under living in New Jersey, and whereas it is estimated that one in 100 children experiences abuse, and whereas childhood maltreatment and abuse are part of adverse childhood experiences and create long-term trauma that has lifelong impacts, and whereas child abuse is a significant social problem that creates significant effects for entire families, communities, and society as a whole, and whereas all children deserve to be nurtured, protected, and free from physical or emotional harm, and whereas the state of New Jersey and the New Jersey Department of Children and Families believe that healthy families raise healthy children, and whereas the state of New Jersey is committed to offering a continuum of community-based child abuse prevention and intervention programs that are culturally competent, strength-based, and family-centered, and whereas the New Jersey Department of Children and Families embraces the standards for prevention programs developed by the New Jersey Task Force on Child Abuse and Neglect, and whereas all sectors of the community, including law enforcement, medical professionals, schools, courts, and media outlets, as well as numerous public and private agencies, have joined forces to promote public awareness and community involvement in keeping children and their families safe, healthy, and connected during the month of April and continuing throughout the year. Now, therefore, I, Philip D. Murphy, Governor of the State of New Jersey, do hereby proclaim April 2019 as Child Abuse Prevention and Awareness Month. Thank you. Does that conclude the report, sir?
It does. Thank you very much.
It is now time for committee and committee updates and liaison reports.
I don't know, they may be here because they are interested in budget conversation. Sure, come forward.
Would you like to open public comment, sir?
Sure.
If I may, that way we can, is that rather than? Okay, changing the order of the day, it is now time for the first public comment. At your pleasure, sir. Whereas the Howell Township Board of Education determined comments from the public may last 45 minutes, and those comments may be conducted in accordance with our bylaw 164.1, may be limited to 3 minutes each. The officer of respect to time and decorum will be the president of the board, Mr. Bongiovanni. With your permission, may the floor be open.
Please.
Please. Bruce, would you bring the microphone over, please?
or you go to it, or it come to you, one or the other.
No, we need it for the recording.
Yes.
Name and address, please.
My name is Jeannie Malilly. I'm at 19 Westbrook Road in Howell. I'm here today because I'm very concerned about the ongoing bullying of my son at Middle School South. It's unacceptable, and it's becoming very troublesome for my son. I've approached the principal, and the child was moved from the lunch table, but today my son comes home, and the kid is back at the table, and this is happening every day at drawing lunch. Something has to be done. I don't know what else to do. I've taken proper channels, but nothing is being done. And my son going himself and approaching the principal, guidance counselor, and everybody else will listen to him and complaining, and he wants to go to the police department and file harassment charges. What does this tell someone? It's telling someone child's had enough. He's at his breaking point. He's had enough. And one day of bullying is one day too many for anybody. Something has to be done.
Thank you. I'm sure Mr. Rizzoli will follow up with
you. Yeah, if you could just give Mr. Sanicek your name again, so I'll take it. I'll follow up tomorrow. Tomorrow's Thursday, so I'll follow up tomorrow morning with the schools, get some information, and I'll be in touch with you.
We followed an HIV.
Okay.
So I just wanted to say that. And I'm assuming, just my thought, that we follow this, and the kid was removed from the lunch table, but it was back today. So I'm assuming maybe the principal didn't feel it was anything really big enough to complain or feel that it was anything done. But he's not being bullied. My son is every single day.
Mr. Rizzoli will be following up with you in regards to this.
I understand that, but I'm just saying then if something more takes place in a cafeteria when a child can't take anymore, then the other child gets penalized too for defending himself. And this is what I do not want to see. So I want some action taken.
Thank you.
Further public comment at this time? Seeing none, shall we go back to committee liaison reports,
please,
sir? At your pleasure.
Start from the right. Anybody? Mr. Miller.
Finance Committee met on April 10th. Mr. Sanicek introduced Ms. Dizola, the superintendent of schools, who was sitting in the meeting for Mr. Bruce Preston, our assistant superintendent for curriculum and personnel. Ms. Dizola discussed with the committee how the education department has been very mindful of their purchases and what can be done with what they have. Science kits are a prime example of using what we have and purchasing what additional supplies we need in order to keep costs down. Mr. Sanicek then began the discussion on S2 with a short PowerPoint presentation, which we will show this evening. He explained to the committee that the tentative budget was sent to the county superintendent for review after approval by the board. A reviewer at the superintendent's office questioned the district as to why we wouldn't use all of our bank cap with the cuts due to the S2 bill that was recently passed into law. This year, our unused bank cap is valued at approximately $945,000, which would expire and fall off the table next year. So the committee had a long discussion on it, if it is prudent to use some or all of the bank cap this year. Mr. Sanicek displayed the calculation of tax rate, which would be valuable to show the potential impact if any bank cap was added. It ranged from $7 to $30 annual on the average house. Discussion ensued if the district uses the bank cap and how that would affect our budget and surplus funds going forward. The committee voted to recommend using the full bank cap for this year. The vote was 3 in favor, 2 opposed, 1 abstention. The committee chair asked that this be brought to the full board this evening for discussion at this meeting. The committee reviewed the budget transfer report and voted to recommend it for its approval tonight, which is on the agenda. The March 15th minutes were approved by the committee that evening. I attended the National School Board Conference on March 30 to April 1st. While I was there, I attended a few sessions on social emotional learning, as well as the session on our board president superintendent did on board superintendent relationships. I attended the National School Board New Jersey School Board Association School Mental Health Conference. There was an excellent presenters at this conference that Mr. Bon Giovanni had just spoke about. I attended our District P3 Maker Fair on April 2nd. It was great to see the wonderful presentations by our students. I also attended the Southwest Side Story Play on April 4th. The students did an amazing job. It was like I was attending a Broadway play. I attended the Howell Township Education Foundation's Evening of Stars. As always, they did an excellent job recognizing the stars in our district. Today's Student Board of Ed Day was great. The students were excellent leaders and did a wonderful job both this morning and this evening. The Monmouth County School Board Association's next meeting will be on Thursday, May 2nd at 6 p.m. in the Colts Inc. Inn. Mrs. Malley will be receiving an award that evening for certified board member. So I ask the board members and administration, if you can, to please come out and support her. Lastly, I would like to wish everyone a safe and enjoyable spring break. Thank you.
Mr. Miller, for either yourself or Mr. Sanasek, whichever wants to take it up first, could you touch a bit more on the CAP situation, maybe go into just a touch more detail on options, what it involves?
I was going to bring up the discussion items.
Yeah, it's really a piece of the committee report. Let's go for it now.
Would you like me to do the PowerPoint?
So as Mr. Miller said, the there was a discussion. It was not anything in rejection or anything, but there was discussion about, you know, the oncoming cuts in state aid that we know we're experiencing under S2, and a question of whether it would be prudent to take the bank cap. And I have to preface this by saying, and I told Finance Committee, my initial answer was exactly what Mr. Isola and Mr. Bon Giovanni presented down in Philadelphia, what they presented at Atlantic City years before, and what we're very proud of saying, that we have a wonderful relationship between administration and board. And there's a trust level that when we need it, we ask for it, and when we don't need it, we don't ask for it. And that response was met with a kind of curious answer of, well, does that give you $12,700,000 in the seventh year? And the answer was obviously no. So we do have some things coming on the horizon that we've talked about, that we're making plans for, that Mr. Miller and the Finance Committee and various administrators have talked about, but we felt that it was important for that discussion to take place here and for us to at least have the understanding of what our bank cap would mean. So I began with the impact review and the strategy. We know that last year, 2018-19, the original governor's budget said we were getting $382,000 additional dollars rather than a cut. And then when the final state budget came out in July, we actually experienced a cut of $913,000. So this year, unlike last year, we didn't get more money in the governor's budget, but we actually were told that we were losing $1.6 million in state aid over that governor's budget the year before. So then I just put the question marks up there because we don't know what the legislature is actually going to come up with for July. There is nothing coming out that's saying we're going to get more cuts. I'm not trying to say that, but we didn't know the cuts were coming last year either. So anything is possible. We are following things in Trenton with their success or their failure. Income tax revenues are down. We're not sure what's happening with marijuana revenue. It's a small amount, but we still don't know what's happening with that. And some other things are being discussed at the senatorial and administrative levels. So we don't know. So we have our hearing on May 6th. We're awaiting the news. We still don't know what might happen. So I just put the little comment that the morning of May 7th, all we have to look forward to is regrets if we don't think we made the right decision. Because once we vote the budget on May 6th, that bank cap is still available for next year, but it could not be used this year absent legislative changes. Now again, maybe what they do in July is to give us relief on other things. There's a couple bills pending. But right now, under the current legislation, whatever we do on May 6th is the final for next year's spending plan. So this shows the difference. I don't have a pointer. I had a pointer with me at anyway, if you see the blue line, that's the 18-19. Then you see what happens if we do take, I'm sorry, if we don't, the green is if we don't take the bank cap that's available and we wait till next year, and the yellow is if we do take it. So you'll see that is that $935,000. Basically, that is the difference, excuse me, in those two columns. So then as you go forward through the years, you see that they become more similar because we've taken it then. This would look very similar the following year if we don't take it this year. So by the time we get to the end, it's about a $20,000 difference in that last year, because what we're doing is compounding the money over the 5 years. Does that make sense? Okay. So this chart, I'm always very proud to show this chart. This over the last... I think 15 years almost, has been a steady progressive line of the working together that we do to make sure that we are economizing and being as efficient as possible. The purple line on top, although our total budget is higher, our response to try to save the taxpayers' money has been continuing down as a percentage of their total tax bill. So you see the purple line on top is the local school tax, and the other three are the county, the regional school, and the municipality. So that's something we're very proud of. So that weighs on our mind when we're making these recommendations and having this discussion. And then what I did for the committee, and I'm ready to do it here as well, this is the calc of tax rate that has been something we show every year at our both tentative budget for the finance and also at the public hearing for the budget when we presented on May 6th. But I added a box where if anybody wanted to see what any amounts of the bank cap being added to the levy would do, right now with the budget that was approved as a tentative budget, and again, we always recognize that it is tentative, the May 6th is really the effective date. The average house, which this year is estimated by the township to be about $352,000 of assessed value, the current budget would increase $7 for the year on their taxes. A de minimis amount, but still it's $7. We recognize that it is $7. But if during the discussion anybody wants to proffer an amount, I can put it in there and it'll show us what the impact to that average house would be. And what that means on the average house, if you know what your assessment is, if your assessment were to be, say, $704,000, you would be double that. And if your assessment were to be $176,000, you would be one half of that. So whatever increment of that average house your assessed value represents, you would multiply that times the $7. So that is the presentation that I gave to finance. And if that makes sense, yes, Mr. Miller.
So at the Finance Committee meeting, like I said, there was a final vote to take the full amount, which would be, if we change that into there, it would be $30, I believe.
Let's see if it works. All right, Ms. Mercado took care of me here. So
then I also asked Mr. Sanasek, while he's doing this, to look at taking half of it, which would cover about what we lost at the last minute last year and would give us a little cushion to be if we get that last minute cut. And it would still be showing restraint to the district, to our taxpayers, that we're not going out and using all of it in this year. But it will also show that if we do get this cut at the last second, that we're still be able to sustain the cut. So this is
so
half
I
of
guess,
it.
While Mr. Miller's talking, I put a formula in for half. So you see the half is 472, 932, and you see that the $7 changes to $19 for the year.
So we looked at both of them. Of course, like I had in my report, I did say that the full amount is the one that the committee
ultimately the majority of the committee did send for us for discussion this evening. But, you know, I did ask for the discussion for the full board this evening on what, you know, we all think and would give us time to, you know, gather our thoughts before the public hearing. Plus, we're not taking a vote this evening because we don't want to tie the hands of the Finance Committee for any last-minute changes between now and the public hearing, because if we hear from now and then that we're going to get cut a huge amount, you know, we can make that change up until the May 6th. Right, so that's why we're not looking for a vote this evening, but we do felt that the full board needed to know where we're at, and would like to get the full board to weigh in on what the thoughts of the Finance Committee were so far.
Well, may I?
Please. Okay.
Well, I was one of the votes that was not supporting using the 100%, taking 100% of the bank cap this year, because I think the tentative budget at $7 jumping to now being $30, I think that's damaging to the relationship that we've built trust with the community, that we are being fiscally responsible. I think I would be much more supportive of the 50%, because that's less of a jolt, and then we do the other 50%, so we're not losing it at all, but we're being more, we're staying true to our commitment to the community and to the taxpayers, and that's where my point was.
So before the next person speaks, so Mr. Sanasek, that's correct with that we could do half this year,
yeah,
and it would still leave half on the table for next year?
Yes.
Then it would fall off the table.
Yes.
If we don't use it next year.
If we don't take it next year, it is not available in the next budget year because it has become expired. Falls off the table, as we colloquially say it.
Thank you. Mr. Izzola?
Sure. As the superintendent and chief school officer, I think it's important for my voice to be on the record here. So I agree with what Ms. Malley was saying. I think we've worked hard not to utilize every ounce of taxing authority that we've had over the years, and when needed we've went to the max in certain years. I think you have charged me as a board over the year to have a five-year plan. I think some of the things that change that conversation is the state's method of implementing formerly S2, the new funding formula, has taken away the foresight that districts were able to have in the past. We are facing approximately $12 million in a seven-year period, this being year two of that. That is substantial fall off of state aid. That is not something that is, you know, we'll buy a few less pencils. That money is, you know, absolutely substantial. My concern, and I happenstance was there because I was filling in for my assistant superintendent who couldn't attend the meeting for some strange reason, and I was glad to be part of that dialogue because it was such an important dialogue, but what I communicated that night is the budget that we put forth at $7, which we're very proud of, was, you know, really tight, and it should be. School districts should take what they need and nothing more from the taxpayers. However, it does not leave room for massive adjustments should something occur, should there be, you know, some new initiative or environment that we're looking to work. And I've been clear, and this is not shocking or new to anyone at this dais or hopefully in this community, that student and staff wellness is a priority of this district. It has been for years. It is in the forefront. I have emphasized it. Mrs. Callender and her department continue to work diligently on that. And there are things that I am looking at that do come with a price tag, but also deliver resources to our school system that could change the lives of individuals. So, and I don't know that if it's this year or next year, I don't know when or if it's totally appropriate for us. but I'm exploring these different things, and the current budget does not afford us the opportunity to expand on new happenings and bring things to the district. I'm okay with that as long as we know that. So when this conversation started, you know, I made that statement at finance to Mr. Miller and his committee and to both the citizen committees that were there. So it was a very, I just wanted to state that because I don't want that to be lost. If this budget that we have is passed, and I was part of the recommending group of that budget, I'm good. I just want you to know that if we don't exercise any of this, and that's okay, if we don't exercise any of this taxing authority, it does limit us for some of the things that may be happening around some important work in this district. And that's something we may have to live with over the next additional 5 years based on state aid cuts under S2. Let's be clear, we're a loser in that conversation, the state's decision to redistribute the education funds. So I just wanted to be on the record, but I couldn't agree more with what Ms. Malley said. I think to go to the max, I was feeling that was not the right move. It's obviously the board's discretion to do that. You make those decisions, but I know that you often look to me for where I feel we are as a district. So we will, certainly, I kind of agree with Ms. Malley. If we can build in some protection of the district's progress, I think that's healthy. I think Matt Clark from the citizen membership of the committee used that word. This is an opportunity to protect the district's interest and also be respectful to taxpayers. So I didn't want to be absent of it. I thought that'd be negligent on my part as your superintendent. So I hope that sheds a little light on where I'm coming from, and I'm certainly here to participate in this further dialogue in any way you desire.
I just would not recommend taking the whole thing. People are very sensitive about taxes right now because they're very upset about the new tax law that was passed, and they're getting smaller refunds or paying more, even though they're not looking at what they got in their withholding. So any increase that we propose will be even more negatively perceived than it would be in another year. So I would like to say that I'm against taking it all. I am sympathetic to getting some of it and saying that there are things, getting a little buffer and getting things that we might want to use to move forward the district, but I would be very against taking the whole thing.
After hearing the full conversation and kind of weighing, all the arguments here, I tend to agree with Ms. Malley and Dr. Jeffrey here that I think 50% max would kind of be where we're looking for this year. There's a lot of, obviously, unpredictability right now with what's going on with the state, but I think it's less of a burden at that point if we can regulate that way and keep it at around that 50% number.
I would tend to agree with Ms. Malley as well. I think, like Mr. Thor said, the state, you never know if they're going to cut what they said they were going to cut or if they're going to cut more. So I believe having that half of the cushion would, it would be a happy medium in between taking nothing and taking all of it.
Okay, so with anything, there are things we can control and things we can't. Tax bill, it's already been passed and voted on by Congress. We can't control that, in addition to the change in the funding formula. So there are a couple things that I heard. I'm actually in favor of keeping the full amount. And because there are things that we know that we want to do, and part of the things that make us such a great district, and the education that we provide. So I think more being able to explain to people, as I'm a taxpayer as well, while all these things that are out of our control, the things we can control are continuing the programs and the things that we want. So they're hard and difficult decisions to make, but I'm always more of, it's the explanation. We do have the good relationship with the community, so I think if we, through community interaction, get out there and explain, times have changed. And so I'm really in favor of keep doing the full amount to keep the things that are really, really important to us and continue as much as we can for the time that we have to be able to provide the programs. And I, without a doubt, feel for so many reasons, but particularly here today from our children, that there's a lot of social emotional needs and that wellness need. And would be to talk about all this and then not be able to deliver on it, in my opinion, wouldn't be good.
Dr. Lowe, so you're saying to take the whole thing this year or leave the whole thing?
No, I'm in favor of the full. It's all about explanation, explaining to community, because we do have a good relationship with our community. So it's us messaging out the why with the things that we can control as a board, the other things we can't control.
I'm going to ask another question. If we take this and don't use it, it carries over. Is that correct? Goes into
the surplus.
Yes. Is there any messaging that we can use that for to recover from?
That was a discussion at finance as well. And if we do take it as a, say, prophylaxis and don't use it, it would, under the current budget in the way that I'm envisioning, it would be returned to maintenance reserve and be available to alleviate issues in future budgets. So yes, I think that's your question, right?
Yes, thank you.
This is my, I'm sorry.
Can we roll out some of the new wellness programs and other initiatives that we're looking at in stages to try to come up, you know, with that medium, with not spending a full amount? Is that feasible?
So the specific program I'm looking at, I'm in the infancy of this investigation. I've spoken to some districts that are utilizing these services, and I've met with the company. Mrs. Callender and I attended some presentations and workshops on it. It's really good work, but I don't want to be misleading here. I'm not suggesting that, get me the money so I can bring this to the district. These are things that we want to explore, and I can't do that on the original proposal, and I get that. We'll continue to work forward. But if we're going to be a forward-thinking district and protect the interest of our students and our staff, having those resources and dollars there so that we could do innovative work certainly is something that will allow us to fully explore that. And yes, there are probably elements of certain programs that can be chunked, but I don't have enough research today, and I'm not going to rush the decision and say, hey, I need all the money, go give it to me so I can go do. That's not what I'm trying to say at all, but we want to look at developing and securing the most amount of support we could for families and students that are in need, and and make them be as successful in the environments that we have, that we have here, and maintaining in-district students as much as possible. Those are important things to our mission, and sometimes that requires a spend, and then there's cost avoidance in the future because it's fewer kids leaving the district, right? So that money comes back over the years in terms of investments. But again, I'm not ready to make a recommendation, and I don't want to be misleading here. I just won't do that. So yes, Mr. Thor, I think there's could be a level of chunking in terms of rolling programs out and supports out, but we want to be diligent about the work. And if we should support a budget, there are some at our dais, what I'm hearing is, just to protect the district's interest, we should be doing this, regardless of any specific program or whatever it may be. So I don't want to mislead the conversation, but I also want to tell you that I know I have the trust of this board when I tell you we do our research, we're diligent about things. When we make purchasing decisions, we've demonstrated that, whether it's a pencil, whether it's a staff member, whether it's an outside vendor to deliver services. Whenever we do that, we do our homework about that, and we're in our homework stages of this, so it's a little bit premature, but I can tell you that in the tentative budget, it will be limiting to things like that. That doesn't mean we're going to fail. It just means that it could be limiting, right? And we'll have to continue to work and find resources and mechanisms to deliver services in every other way possible, and then perhaps in the future. I don't have a crystal ball, but I don't see us avoiding utilizing this money. We'd be the only district in the state that probably let that money expire, that level of money expire next year when it falls off the table, as they say. So what I think the board is faced with, and I can't, again, I'm not a crystal ball here, but what I think the board's decision and conversation is focusing on is it prudent to take some now to safeguard the district's interest, and then there's less to take next year, or is it take it all next year to offset the 2.4 that's projected to fall off, whatever that number is, that's projected to fall off next year as a battle to that. So it's complex, I get that, but I guess the long version of a short answer is, I'm sure certain programs could be chunked in, but when we're talking about wellness and kid success, that looks different from day to day, right?
I can't do this with a short answer. I apologize. This district has often talked about the fact that we plan and we look and we look 5 years out. We don't look at tomorrow, we look 5 years out. What are we gonna need? How are we gonna provide? What can we do? I think it is important to recognize the fact that I'm gonna combine that with, when it comes to our current, I'm gonna walk the line here. When it comes to our current state, New Jersey, and it comes to what's happening with the federal government, I don't have a lot of confidence that May 7th won't have been changed. It could be exactly the same. I hope it is. But I don't personally have a lot of confidence in what I see coming out of Trenton in terms of money coming to districts. And that's especially true when I pick up the paper and I look at what happens to other districts, who's gaining, who's losing. Sometimes some of those decisions, as we read the paper in our own home, makes no sense to us. So again, not having a lot of trust in the state, knowing that too often we have sat at this table and talked about unfunded mandates, and I do believe, and you and I have had conversation about this, I do believe that whether we take it on as an initiative ourselves or whether it's placed upon us, I do believe SEL and wellness issues are going to be something that sooner or later the state is going to tell us to do. There are other unpredictables. I almost hesitate to even say this one, but what if 2 months from now a charter puts in an application in Howell and somehow it gets approved? There's another chunk of our money being pulled from what we do. And having said all that, I need to go back to the conversation I had with 15 students today, 15 fifth graders, and I said, here are the things we need to think about. We need to think about the students first. What might we have to take from the students someday if we don't have that money to protect us or to go into an initiative like Mr. Isola is talking about. And I hear him saying that this isn't definitely what's going to happen with the money, but if that were to something the district were to move towards, whether by choice or by mandate, at least we know it's there. I told them we need to think about their parents and the community, and I recognize that we're talking about for the average home a $30 increase if we take the whole thing. Look, I pay the taxes like everybody else, and I don't want to minimize $30. That hits me just like it hits everybody else, knowing there's also going to be a regional increase, knowing the municipal government. I was sitting next to Mr. Thor when you had this up here, and he mentioned, like, look at the line from other taxes, the municipal line, where how it sharply it's grown over the years. I realize I'm on the box here, and I apologize, but I will be unapologetic about the fact that I think we need to protect the opportunities we provide to our students. I think we need to protect the opportunities we give our staff to provide those services. If I'm gonna talk it, I guess I have to walk the line. I would personally be in favor of taking the money, knowing that impacts my household just like it does everybody else. I'd also be the person who would be more than willing to be in front of a microphone along with other members who may or may not agree today, trying to explain to the public, here's why a decision was made. I know I'm one voice. The reason we wanted this conversation to take place tonight is because we have some time until the 6th and we take a vote. But I think it was important for everybody to hear everybody else's thoughts on it. It gives us time. Follow-up? Comments? Questions?
This is going to be a messaging issue, whatever Absolutely. We decide to take. And if, as you pointed out, we have time to form that message, I think that's what we should be working on now. Whether it's half or all of it, the message is gonna have to be out so that the community doesn't feel they're being betrayed.
I almost think that the news has helped us already in some of that messaging. And by that, what I mean is I think that, again, I will refer to the newspapers, the TV, the reports we've had from around this state on what districts have gained or lost. I'm willing to stand before the public and say other people have seen gains. We've lost 1.6, and are potentially losing more because of how fiscally conservative and aware and looking at every penny this district has done in the past. I don't want to take a shot on being the district that someday says, what do we have to do to impact the district, and how is that going to impact the students? I realize I'm the minority, what I'm saying, it's how I feel. Mr. Miller.
Unfortunately, with the news, I'm going to have to disagree. The only reason I'm going to have to disagree is because recently we got a write-up in a local paper when we put out our tentative budget, and we had Facebook giving kudos to our district for how fiscal responsible we were of only raising the taxes $7. So sending the message out, well, now it's not $7, it's $30. We do need, if you're looking at raising it the full amount, you do need to get that message out. Because now the district, the community's gonna wanna know, well, what happened, why am I getting an additional $23 increase? When you put out a tentative budget and you said to us, that's what you needed to survive for the year, now, all of a sudden, now you're telling me you need another $945,000. We see it that we need it. Yes, but the community sees something different. They see the region going out with three questions. They see that a municipal going up a large amount. That's why when we were at finance, my idea of even with the cushion of going half, you know, it's this year we're losing, we know we're losing 1.6. Next year we're losing 2.4. So if we took half this year and we took half next year, where we're getting a larger decrease, you know, that was my thing. We're showing fiscal responsibility to the community, plus we're showing, you know, restraint on, you know, something that we've worked on for many years. You know, when we built this trust with the community, and if the board wants to increase its full amount, we do need to get that message out. You know, we need to explain to the community why we're going from 7 to 30.
We'll even need to do that if we go half.
Well, even if we go half, yes. We need to get the message out. You know, I mean, they do see other districts being cut. Yeah, yes, it is in the news, but that my personal feel that the tentative budget is a disservice to the district when we announce it, because the community doesn't see a tentative budget and a final budget as two different things. Once they see that tentative budget and they think those are the numbers, great, let's run with them. You know, and then we come out with the final budget, they don't understand, you know, what the difference is in that, you know, it's a budget process.
This is especially true, and some of you may remember it, some of you may not be aware. It's especially true, not only was it on Facebook, but Mr. Miller and I attended a meeting of an organization we were invited to, and we proudly sat there and said, here's what we anticipate. Although I did at the time, and I do it every time I talk about it, say tentative is the word that has to be bold, capitalized, italics, large font, you know, understand what the word tentative means. But again, you know, I recognize the fact that what I'm proposing, and I think I'm not the consensus vote from what I'm hearing right now, but I'm willing to go back to that same group and say, here's what's changed. It's me. Mrs. Mallory.
Adding on to what Mr. Miller said, you know, I understand that you want to put the word tentative in lights, but people see it and they do connect with that's the tentative budget. That is the budget. And going back and explaining that we went from 7 to 30, going from 7 to 19, I think you can explain that a lot easier than going up to 30 and the full amount. People would be more understanding of a smaller increase than a full, and then looking at that going, well, what do you need 900, almost, you have almost $1 million for what? What do you need it? What do you need that for? Because we might get a cut, because we might do some new programs, because we might,
I understand.
As a taxpayer, to me, I'd be like, then you're basically taking all this extra money on maybe.
Gotcha.
Taking it on past practice because of what the state always cuts more than they say they're
true.
Going to.
Which is, but explaining that again, and considering that it is now one more day before spring break, and then when we get back from spring break, we have what, a week before we're going to approve our budget. How much time that gives us to get a message out to the community is not. It's very limited, in my opinion, about it.
And taking the half is approximately what we cut at the last minute last year. So
right.
If the message that we really, if we decide to take half, it's really, we're preparing ourselves for the approximate cut that we received last year.
If we get that cut,
we've got it. The number that we need to be sustainable for the year. If we don't, you know, at least we have the money, you know, to put it, you know, in surplus or use for programs. You know, we still have whatever is it, 400 and whatever number is up there.
Mr. Thor.
While I will regrettably not be able to be in attendance on May 6th, you know, from hearing all the comments, and I think this has been a very thoughtful discussion. I still personally am against, and I would vote, I'd be opposed to the full 100%. I'd like to keep it at that 50% maximum threshold if possible. That would be my vote if I was able to be with us on May 6th. So I just want to put that on the record.
Well, that's why I thought it was important for this conversation to take place tonight, to give a sample time to talk to each other, to continue to do research, and continue to think about it. Further comments? Dr. Lowe?
Just one last discussion. My comments are still the comments, but something, the issue with the Facebook. So who's driving the bus? We know this is the world we live in with social media, but who is driving the bus? You know, we do have a good relationship with our community. And I'm not making assumptions, but we can't assume that what people put on Facebook, it's anonymous, it's people who have, you know, whatever. So just to rethink that, you know, my decision is still a decision. We have a lot of trust in our community.
I was talking about the newspaper.
But Facebook was mentioned also, too. Someone mentioned Facebook. Right, but once again, it's all media, social media, paper media, whatever.
Well,
so
the newspaper is not anonymous. We know who the reporter is.
True. Yes. Right. But I'm just saying, I still want to say who's driving the bus.
No, I'm saying.
Yeah.
You weren't thinking that I was saying an anonymous person.
No, I understand.
We know who the
It's all media.
I think we have a very good trust with the community. I just think we have to be conscious that we have to maintain that trust, and that if we're obviously if we are being viewed as not being fiscally responsible in a year where we're not just getting, you know, taxed once, we're getting taxed twice because of what's happening with the regional, and the regional, you know, obviously is now floating out you know, referendum, thank you, for a second time after being defeated last year. There's already public opinion regarding that, you know, for right or wrong, and obviously that's not our business. You know, we're not a K-12 district, we're K-8, but I feel as if we are not conscious of that public trust that we do have, we could be in jeopardy of straining that relationship.
Can I add one thing? I think the messaging is simpler if we can say, we were very worried, we were very nervous, and we were thinking about taking it all, but we realized that would be potentially tough on you, and we only took half. That continues the message of us being fiscally conservative and responsible, but it gets us some of that money in case it gets a cut. So I think we win two ways.
Seeing no further comments, Mr. Miller, thank you very much. Mr. Sansak, thank you for the presentation.
Thank you.
Dr. Lowe, education?
Exactly, most of the houses are here.
Okay. Ms. Malley.
Oh, me? Okay. All right, operations. Operations met on April 10th. The HVAC was the first topic. Ardina was going well and on schedule for April 15th. However, the weather could delay the actual startup because we need 55 to 60 degrees to turn it on. And I don't think we've really had consecutive days of that temperature, have we, Mr. Sanizak?
No, today was beautiful, but still. But it is going to be wonderful when we turn it on.
Yes,
tell you
it will be wonderful when we turn it on. So it's ready to be turned on, but okay. The original bid for the remaining HVAC work has to be rejected because one contractor made an error in the bid and the other didn't bid on all the items, and that rejection is on the agenda this evening as 6002. The new bidding process actually divides the work into three sections. We have the unit vent replacement, we have the middle school's boiler, chiller, and CHP, and we have the district controls. And the reason why they separated into three was in the hopes that more contractors would bid one or more of those sections. Those bids happened to be open today during Student Board of Education Day, so that was great exposure.
My counterpart joined me in the bid opening.
Yeah,
she
that
found
was
that
really
very
cool.
Exciting. It was neat.
That was really cool. Because we knew that the bids were probably going to be open today, the committee approved a recommendation at this evening's meeting by Mr. Sanizak, so we can stay on schedule for the remaining buildings by September. They're on the agenda tonight for 6003, 6004, and 6005. And Mr. Sanizak will be reading those in, I am assuming, right before we do the consent agenda.
They are
agenda.
Printed, but I have a modification to read in when we get there, ma'am.
When we get there, okay. So the reason why we gave our permission or our recommendation to Mr. Sanizak is because it's important to stay on track for September for the remaining buildings. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the next item was the food services. Lunches and participation is going well. We discussed the communication with parents, especially regarding the collections of overdue accounts. There are two types of communication. One is from my school box. which generates three notices of low balance, which is below $10, via email. In addition, Aramark also sends letters when the balance falls more than $10 in arrears. The first letter is sent home in the backpacks, and I guess the communication issue was whether they were actually then getting into the hands of the parents, because things fall into backpacks sometimes and are never seen again. Then there's a second letter that is then mailed to the parents. Once the balance owed reaches $50, it's sent to the business office, Mr. Sanisak, and a registered letter is then mailed. So the committee requested new options be researched, such as using school messenger, power school notes, emails from the principals potentially, closing access to the portal for bus and homeroom info in August, September until balance is paid, et cetera. Throughout this process, however, Aramark still provides food to the student. It may be limited meal choice, but no child goes hungry. That is our policy. Then the next thing, with the minutes were approved. I had the honor of participating in the Middle School South Poetry Night on March 27th. Quite a few students read original poems, and the art club displayed their work. It was a wonderfully creative evening, and I was excited to be part of it. I attended both middle schools' plays. I was able to see Hairspray as well as West Side Story, and I was at all three nights of West Side Story because my daughter happened to be in it, which is pretty cool. But both plays were fantastic, and it was awe-inspiring, the talent on that stage, both schools. It was hard to believe I was watching middle school students perform. These kids work hard, and it showed. And the P3 Expo was a huge success, a great community evening showcasing the talents and innovative ideas our students are encouraged and allowed to pursue, proving once again the great work that happens in our classrooms every day. And I was thrilled again today to participate in Student Board of Ed. So that was just a wonderful day. Thank you. That concludes my report.
Sure. The community interaction meeting, the last was held on March 27th at Taunton Elementary School. As I've discussed, one of our plans this year is that we're going to try to move meetings around to not only different areas of town, and sometimes it'll be in schools, sometimes it'll be in media centers, sometimes it'll be in a public restaurant or something like that, which we have tried this year. We're also going to move it to different days of the week after my conversation with Mr. Isola, as people have, you know, different days of the week, they have different obligations, so this will allow more people who have a vested interest to be able to attend. At the meeting on March 27th, and Mr. Bongiovanni, thank you for being in attendance. Mr. Gurman was also there that evening, and they were able to take part in the conversation. First topic that was discussed that evening was the school polling. There had obviously been, for many, many years, probably 3 or 4 years, discussion in the community about could we get the election day polling out of the schools, and you know, with the cooperation of the county, municipal partners, polling locations have been moved out of Howell schools effective immediately. So that obviously was something that was important that we communicated with the community, and I think that shows that the hard work that we all have put in working together was able to solve what was could have been potentially been an issue. So we were all very appreciative of that. The school budget, which will clearly be a issue that we will continue to discuss at community interaction and at many other committees going forward, was discussed at the March 27th meeting. Mr. Isola shared the tentative budget and talked about the reduction in state aid and some of the challenges that we are going to have due to that. Mr. Isola also expressed the district's been very good at protecting the educational programs in the district because of our cost savings with operations and with being efficient with our energy. We had a discussion regarding the strategic planning update and a discussion regarding the five pillars, the five goals for the upcoming strategic plan, which are learner success, community interaction, talent teams, wellness and operations, and finance. And that administrative subcommittees are meeting to create action steps for each of those goal areas. We had an ESIP update, and it was discussed the basically the flipping of the switch the ribbon cutting at Ardena School. And that is my home school, and I know how warm that school is, so that was obviously a very welcome news there. And we discussed how the ESIP program is going to allow the district to fund energy and capital improvements without raising tax dollars, which obviously is something that we are all very conscious of. Advocacy, and this is where we were thankful that Mr. Gurman was able to be with us, directly discussed was the path to progress and discussions around the state about district consolidation. Not that it's going to happen here, but obviously that has been something that has been discussed around the state. You know, it's not a new conversation. It's been going on for years. But we did have a conversation regarding that. And we decided as a group that advocacy will remain a standing agenda item from here on out at all community interaction meetings going forward, and that we're going to try to align agenda items directly with the advocacy committee, because quite frankly, both those committees really kind of do cross over in terms of common goals and common conversations. We are in the process of setting our next date, which we were talking about doing the week of the board meeting, so potentially, I think Thursday, May 9th, I want to say was the, I wish I had that in front of me, I'm sorry. May 9th was the tentative date. We're going to identify a location and kind of what the agenda will be for that evening. And obviously, a lot of that will be based on what is decided on May 6th with the budget. We know that will be a topic of importance that we want to discuss and have people have a chance to weigh in. And that is the, I think that was everything we discussed at Community Interaction. My first ever report, so thank you.
Okay, so. And thank you for Mr. Miller for reminding me this. So, as you're aware, we had a meeting earlier tonight. We observed a meeting earlier tonight. And coming out of that meeting, let me just note some of the things that came from the different committees. Education talked about approving a resolution to recognize April as Financial Literacy Month. Would that be something we would need to add to the agenda, Mr. Sanisak? If we were to do that?
If you are interested in designating that on behalf of the Howell Township Board of Education, yes, we would make it a whatever number we're up to after I read in the, we can make it A1 and I'll have the executive session thereafter if you would like.
I'm moving into the addendum.
A1 on the addenda will be to for the Howell Township Board of Education to designate April as its Financial Literacy Month. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, I would second that. I thought it was a great conversation that they had about that. A resolution coming out of education approved a recommendation for Community Interaction Committee to explore ways to work with community banks to start a student bank in each school. That would go to your committee, and you and I can have a conversation about that a little bit later if you weren't present for the conversation. What prompted that?
I'd welcome that, thank you.
I'd be happy to do that. Operations talked about authorizing administration to implement a poster and signage contest to identify recyclable items used in the lunchroom, increase awareness and educate students on the method and importance of maximum plastic recycling. Mrs. Malley, would you like to do anything with that tonight or just send it to committee?
I would love to take that on a committee put it on our agenda for next meeting, please.
Okay. And advocacy, authorized Student Board of Education Administration to prepare, execute, and send a resolution to the legislators and governor urging support for action to reduce single-use plastic items such as bags, straws, and drink containers, and request then full adult Board of Education to execute and send a companion resolution. So I was not in the room at that particular time. Did the Student Board Committee for Advocacy come up with one?
Yes. They actually passed at their meeting earlier this evening their resolution, and it was our recommendation that we also pass a companion resolution to submit with them to go to the legislators and the governor. So I would like to move that to A2.
Could we share that first with the rest of the the board person? I'm not sure that I saw that resolution.
The resolution.
No, they did not create the whole resolution.
Yet.
You know, with the whereas is they directed their administration. I guess it's a hypothetical since they don't, you know, they no longer exist.
So
but possibly we could let advocacy write that on behalf of both groups, and then we could visit the school and get the young lady who was superintendent and the young man who was president to sign it and send it in companion with ours. Would that
I would be in favor of doing that, right. If that would.
So maybe if that's your direction, Mr. Isola and I can do that.
Yeah, and I believe they conveniently are from the same school. Coincidentally.
Oh, okay, I did it.
I
that
believe
makes
they're
it, yeah.
Both Bulldogs, if I'm correct.
And then they asked to authorize administration to prepare, execute, and send a resolution to the legislator and governor requesting full funding of programs to address students' stress and improve learning preparedness.
I moved that to A3. That's for social emotional learning. They wanted funding for social emotional learning outside of the funding of a normal budget from the state to come to fund any type of programs for social emotional learning. So it wouldn't be an unfunded mandate; it'd be a funded mandate.
Mr. Isola, would that be a resolution that might come out of your office first to discuss wording and exactly what we would put in it, and then we could bring that back to the board for final approval?
I can certainly be present at the advocacy meeting and work through that committee, or we can look at it. You know, one thing I am categorically against the legalization of recreational marijuana. However, if that should happen, let's earmark those funds to help the families we're going to destroy with that law through social and emotional wellness. So we could talk about that.
So what I'd like to do is, with permission of the rest of the board, I'd like to have a conversation about that first before we go ahead and
this is only to authorize the administration to do it.
Right. Okay. And that's the stuff that came out of the incredible meeting that we witnessed earlier this evening. Mrs. Callender, was there anything out of policy that we needed to hear tonight? I'm actually talking about the policy committee for the adult board.
the real one.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sansek, I think that wraps up.
Were we making an addenda item to direct or just directing advocacy to take it up? Do you want an addenda item directing advocacy?
I spoke to Mr. Gurman about it this evening, prior to this meeting, and he was in favor of administration drawing up the resolutions and having the board approve it at the next meeting.
Okay, so we can just do that as direction to the committee, or do you want an addenda item voted? That was my question. You called it A3, but it's really just direction. The board's norm is to just direct the committee to take it up.
Okay, so then we'll just direct administration to do it.
If that's okay with everybody.
Okay, so then those A3 and 2 will just be?
Will be direction to the advocacy and administration to develop those resolutions.
Right, so yes. Only A1, which is declaring April
financial literacy.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Does that conclude committee report, sir?
It does.
Okay. It is now time for, we do not have a discussion item beyond that. We've taken care of that. It is now time for the consent agenda. If I could have a mover and a seconder.
I'd like to pull 3001.
Along with A1, but to discussion, sir?
Yes, please.
Mr. Bongiovanni, you have a discussion item, 3000-1.
Mr. Miller.
3001, as we see, is the retirement of our assistant superintendent, Mrs. Callender. I've been on this board for a little over 8 years, and I just want to say that working with Mrs. Callender has been an excellent opportunity. She's been a great model for this district. Anytime I had any questions about special education or anything that
dealt with pupil services. I always went to her. I served when she was a safety liaison. So it's just been a great time serving with you as administrative liaison and in your position as assistant superintendent. And we're really going to miss you in this district. You were a great asset, and it was great working with you in the time that I've been on this board.
So did you want to pull that for discussion only, or do you want
to? I just wanted to give my comments about it. But so it's still on it's still on the consent agenda. Sorry.
May I take the do I can I have a move and a second or on the consent,
move it.
Please?
Second.
By Ms. Malley? Was that?
I don't know. Was that me?
Second.
Malley, Mr. Thor.
Thor. Thank you. I would like to read a modification in on 6000-3 to please change the amount to $5,633,000 instead of $5,408,000 and strike the words except Southern School, and then remove item 4, which was for Southern School alone. So 6004 will be removed. 6003 will have Southern School included at the modified number. And with that, may I take the consent agenda and A1?
Please.
Mrs. Malley?
Yes.
Mr. Thor?
Mr. Sanizak?
Yes.
So, I'm sorry. Did we add anything out of exec, and was that necessary?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, thank you. I said I would add exec, and then I
I'm here to help.
Thank you very much. I got confused with the A123. So out of executive session, add A2 and A3. Approve the memorandum of agreement and non-precedent agreement between JM, HTEA, and Howell Township Board of Education as recommended by the Labor Committee and presented in executive session. This A3 will be approve the memorandum of agreement, non-precedent agreement between SG, HTA, and Howell Township Board of Education as recommended by the Labor Committee and presented in executive session. May I take all those? Would the mover and seconder agree to including those in the roll?
Please.
Do you need to move it
yes.
again?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, move. Thank you. Ms. Malley, again, with A1, 2, and 3 included?
Included? Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Thor?
Yes.
Dr. Jeffrey?
Yes.
Dr. Lowe? Mrs. Mangano?
Yes.
Mrs. Okerson? Oh, I'm sorry. Mrs. Okerson did have to leave. I apologize for that. Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Bongiovanni?
Yes, but I recuse myself on 3001, 3007, and 3016.
Thank you. The consent agenda is approved with the three addenda items, 7 votes in favor, none opposed, with the recusal noted for the record. It is time for the second public comment, if I may, sir.
Please.
Whereas the Howell Township Board of Education determines that comments from the public may last 45 minutes and will be conducted in accordance with its bylaw 164.1, individuals may be limited to 3 minutes. The officer who respect the time of the quorum will be the president of the board, Mr. Bongiovanni. May the floor be open.
Sure.
Are there any comments at this time? Seeing none, may the floor be closed.
Move it.
Second. We are adjourned. Thank you very much.